Thank you for connecting with us today. We hope you will enjoy this message from CWC Riverview. We pray this message will bless you and enrich your faith in God. Now, we invite you to open your heart and your spirit as you hear from our pastor, the Word of the Lord.
Hello, welcome again to yet another broadcast of Community Worship Center's CWC Delivered. We're glad that you're here. This is a Sunday morning broadcast. So I realize that I'm sitting down. I'm not normally in this posture when I'm preaching on a Sunday morning broadcast, but it's because of the nature of what we're dealing with. Right now, I'd like to ask you, if this is the first time you're seeing this video, I would encourage you to stop and go back and view part one of this same series, Recognizing Rapture Relevance, and form the foundation for where we're going. There was a lot of time utilized in that first broadcast to speak to what will be the foundation that we build on even today and in moments to come. So I want you to join with us in that. I can't spend a great deal of time rebuilding the same scaffolding. So let's start from there and come back and feel free to join us, all right? We're glad that you're here today. If you're watching this in lieu of being in a church service, I pray that you're well and doing good. I would challenge you to return to your church as soon as you possibly can. I'm certain that they're taking every precaution necessary to ensure that you will not be the recipient of the coronavirus when you arrive there. So do whatever necessary, take whatever precautions are necessary for you to feel comfortable in doing so. But I challenge the body of Christ to get back to the house of God. I challenge you to get back to a place where you're worshiping in person with other folks that are part of your local family. And it's necessary for us to recognize that if the enemy could, the longer he keeps you away, the easier it'll be to become content in not returning. And so I would love to challenge you to get back into your house of worship and be a part of your local body. A lot of times what is excusing us are in fact excuses, and they're not real and valid. We need to press beyond all of those, or we need to question why there is not an interest to return to that place. So I pray the Lord either way will speak to us. But I want us to gather today around the Word of the Lord, and I want us to allow it to speak to our heart and our life. We've been talking about recognizing rapture relevance out of the life of Noah. This is I'm in a setting where I'm teaching what was intended to be a sermon, but even on the day that it was to be delivered, I could only touch on parts of it. There's a lot to this, and so I make no promise as to how many attempts it's going to take in the series of videos before we're able to complete our quest and journey in trying to ascertain what we can decipher from the life and the ministry of Noah. But I want you to stay with me in the journey. Our analytics show that most people start watching a video and 9 minutes later they cease. I'd love to invite you to stay to the very end. I believe that the information that you will get is going to be valuable to you as you take in all kinds of information on a daily basis from a lot of different sources. Let's allow, at least today, in this moment, the Spirit of the Lord and the Word of God to speak into our setting and into our life. I mentioned last week that Noah's story is full of information, but it's also full of indication, things that we need to be aware of, things that we need to be apprised of so that we have hope and confidence in an hour that would want to steal both. And so it's necessary for us to root and ground ourselves in the Word of the Lord and allow that Word to be an anchor for us and a rock-solid foundation for us to stand on. We utilized last week the same scripture that we would utilize today, and that is Genesis chapter 7 as a primary source. Began in verse 1, and then we skipped to verse 4 and read that through verse 7. Challenge you to do that. Also, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, beginning in verse 13 and reading all the way to verse 18, as it describes to us what I believe is a premillennial picture of the rapture of the church. Reiterating yet again, the word rapture never appears in Scripture, but its definition does. And so it doesn't diminish the reality of its function for us in regard to us as the body of Christ, as a believer. But it does find its definition and what I believe to be its formulation in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. I say formulation, but really it's formed from Genesis to Revelation. There are countless, or not countless, but there are numerous opportunities for us to recognize rapture relevance in these things. And because my focus in the month of June was on Noah, I particularly felt a call and a draw to this area. So we're going to discuss that and look at that. And by no means will this be an exhaustive study on the issue, but I certainly hope it will give you opportunity to jump into the idea of what God has done, what God is doing, and allow the Spirit of the Lord to bring you hope and help in this time. And give help to your mind, because really we are in a time where there is a lot of pollution and corruption that the enemy would love to bring through your eye gates and through your ear gates, and then hopefully back out your mouth gate in an effort to murky the waters of your hope and your life and your faith. But the word of the Lord gives us calm assurance that we may remain in the spiritual saddle, if you will, upright and holding on to the reins, because it is the Lord who secures us and keeps us in the day of adversity, in the day of battle, in the day of calamity. And that's all throughout Scripture as well. We stand on that. I challenge you to go back through some of the videos, especially dealing with the idea that God gives us praise in a song, gives us a song of praise in times of problem, but also that God helps His people to stand in the day of adversity. So we trust in all of those things. But Genesis chapter 7, verse 1, "And the Lord said unto Noah, Come thou and all thy house into the ark." God is speaking directly to the one righteous recipient. He is having a conversation, if you will, giving direction to the steps of the righteous just prior to judgment that is about to come. And in this, he is inviting Noah and his family, those who have prepared a decision to follow after the directives as God gave them to Noah and Noah gave it to them. He said, "All of thy house into the ark, for thee have I seen righteous before me in this generation." God is always looking to and fro, searching from corner to corner of the earth, if you will, for those whose hearts are right. And He knows exactly whose are His. And no matter what we may be able to fake on the surface for others, we'll never fool God. Amen. And so He looks directly at the heart of men. He doesn't look on the outside. He told the prophet Samuel, as he was in the company of Jesse's family looking for a man to anoint as the next king, when Samuel the prophet, the man of God, thought certainly Eliab must be the choice because of how he looks, his stature, his being, and all the above, God reminded him that I don't look on the outward man, I look on the inward. You look at what you can see, I look at what I can see, and I see past the exterior to the interior, and I know what's in the heart of a man. And so God is always looking for the heart of men. And when he seen Noah, he recognized righteousness when he saw it. And Noah continued in a faithful, righteous surrender and obedience to God throughout the days of his life and all the building of the ark. And so in that, God invites the righteous to escape ahead of time the judgment that is coming to a world that rejected God. And one of the reasons that I feel like Noah is very much a particular image and pre-picture of the church and the rapture is that God's people are safe in advance of judgment. Now, there would be folks that would say, well, post-tribulation, they could be called in and brought into that place of safety before the judgment comes. But if that were the case, then everybody would be wiped out, so to speak, and there would be no one left to inhabit the earth for the millennial period. So I believe that there will be folks who come to know Christ. Many of them will be Jewish believers who have been converted during that time, and those that were converted by those who were converted, 144,000 will be a remnant unto God from the nation of Israel and the tribes of Israel, and those individuals will, I believe, become harbingers of God's goodness, glory, and grace, and I do believe that they will be part and parcel of the human factor that still exists during that millennial reign. We can get into that another day. But suffice it to say, before judgment arrived, God called the righteous out and put them safely ahead of time. We'll find out in a little bit, 7 days ahead of the judgment, put them in a safe place and preserve them from all that was about to transpire. So here in Genesis chapter 7, 1, I believe is the nutshell foundation for what we believe to be, or what I believe to be, the picture, the pre-developed Polaroid, if you will, of God's plan for the rapture of the church. And then he goes on in Genesis chapter 7, verses 4 through 7, and defines what was occurring there, gave great emphasis on verse 5, asked the people last week in the video to underline this. Noah did according unto all that the Lord commanded him. It's vital for you and I to be people of obedience. We don't ever earn our salvation, but we justify our salvation. We validate our salvation in regard to the fact that my desire is to honor and to please the Lord, not to honor and please myself. And so in that becomes part of that definition of righteousness. We are appointed the righteousness of Christ. We can't earn it on our own. But in that righteousness is a desire, and innate to that righteousness is a desire to honor and to please the Lord. And I think that's vital for us to grasp. And then we read in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18, what Paul would describe to that church as I would believe, a pre-picture of the church in its existence, simultaneous to the occurrence of Christ calling the body out, that we hear coming for us as the bride to receive us. And so I want you to read that for yourself. And then I concluded last week where I'll start today. And here is the whole story in a nutshell of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. The trump of Almighty God will sound. Bodies are coming up out of the ground. For heaven, we are eternally bound. On earth, the bride is no longer found. Take comfort and spread the news around. That pretty much sums it all up. Should be a screen up there at some point that proves that. There'll be some just below us in the notes will be some information on that as well. I believe that God has great plans for us. I believe the catching of the way of the saints, the groom returning for the bride, the evacuation of the righteous, whatever analogy that we decide to use, it's all about the next great event on the horizon for the body of Christ. And I believe that is the rapture of the church. Now, I believe that there are a lot of things that are occurring in the world that we now dwell in. I believe that there is a group of global elitists that would want nothing more than to immediately usher in a one-world government and a one-world currency and a one-world oversight to all kinds of things, from household planning to virus containment. So we have that existing in our world. We have an economy in America that is not as strong as it has been and could be stronger, and yet at the same time is suffering all kinds of difficulty. There's a lot of civil unrest. There's a lot of civil division occurring right now in the nation that we live in. And it's very important for us through all of these things to keep our focus on the Lord and to be reminded that though the world will perish, we who put our trust in God will not. We have an eternity that is apart from this place. And the Bible reminds us, Hebrews speaks of it, that we are strangers passing through. We're pilgrims. We're just camping here. We're just on a short-term camping trip. And eventually we're going to see all this stuff pack up and we're going to take off from here and we're going to be in the presence of the Lord. Gravity will give way to glory and eventually we'll be gone. And I believe that. And I live my life with an understanding that though I have natural tendencies for self-preservation and more so the preservation of people around me that I love, that desire for protection is natural. Glad we have it. But at the end of the day, the Father in heaven protects his children and watches out over them. The bridegroom, our betrothed, doesn't just love us for the moment. He loves us eternally and he loves us deeply. And love is the perpetuation of God's plan. It is the foundation by which we understand that God in his goodness and his mercy is working on our behalf and working towards our good. Eternity is still our aim, our goal, our understanding of attainment in days to come. So let's not trivialize the eternal by putting greater emphasis on the temporal. Let's understand that the Lord is at work in us and that greater things are in store for us. And I believe that darkness is the best backdrop for light to shine. A world of hatred will better cause those who act in sincere love to stand out as authentic. And so it's necessary for you and I not to shrivel away in the corner and hope nothing bad happens. It's time for us to stand up, clothed in the armament of God, Ephesians chapter 6, and allow ourselves to be utilized for the purposes of glorifying God. Noah stood alone as a preacher of righteousness and declared in an audience of people who we know, minus seven other people, would not listen to him. He had seemingly no influence, but God was still working out plans and purposes through this person, and God will do the same with you and I. Now, we've talked about before, and still maintain, the word rapture does not appear anywhere in the Bible, but its lack of appearance as a singular use word does not delineate the reality of its presence or the actuality of its occurrence. The facts about this occurrence are throughout the word of the Lord. I believe the shadow has been cast all the way from Genesis to Revelation, and I believe that the truth is evident that prior, not mid, not post, prior to the tribulation period, there will be a moment. The Bible says, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 52, in the twinkling of an eye, I think the word there is atomos, which means in an indivisible amount of time, less than the speed of blinking your eye, that the church will be instantaneously liberated from the planet Earth. Listen to 1 Corinthians 51, preceding it. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. It's appointed unto man to die once. There's no such thing as reincarnation. You need to make the most of what you got while you have breath in your body, because there's nothing afterwards, minus the receptivity of the choices you made while you had opportunity to do so. You need to accept the Lord. The Bible is very clear. Isaiah, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon the Lord while he's near. We don't have the promise of tomorrow. The Bible says our life is but a vapor. We need to make our choices while we have opportunity. Don't delay with God. Do today with God what you sense the Spirit of the Lord invoking you, inviting you to do. You need to give your heart and life to God. But here's what he says. We shall not all sleep. There will be those who are alive today, I believe, that will never taste earthly death. You will be alive, and you'll be alive and sustained supernaturally through the millennial period, and you will rule and reign in that period with Christ before the last and final judgment and opportunity for people to rebel against God is given, so that when heaven is repopulated and a new heaven and a new earth are created, it will be populated. There will never be blood again on this earth. No one will ever die for any other reason, and everybody there will have made Jesus their choice in the face of multiple choices. So that purging and that cleansing and that filtering will all be finished by the end of the millennial reign, and it will be revealed to all of those who have died without Christ that there is none that are righteous outside of him. None can be even hopefully righteous in themselves. Amen. We need Jesus. He is the only way, not a way, the only way for salvation to come into our heart and our life is to accept him as the Son of God, the Savior, our substitute, given in our stead so that our sin was paid for in his death, so that in his resurrection we too may live eternally and have the promise of everlasting life. Behold, 1 Corinthians 15, 51, behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. Verse 52, in a moment, in an atomos, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortality must put on immortality. Amen. I believe that there will be a last trump. I think there will be an initial trump, and I believe there will be a last trump. And I believe that at that last trump, we will all be consummated in that place of eternity prior to the new heaven and new earth, and that everything will be completed, finalized, and brought to an end. And the corruptible, this flesh nature that would normally die and eventually return to ash, or dust rather, it is going to be absolutely made perfect and made conformable and will take on immortality. When Jesus appeared after his resurrection, he was in a glorified body, an immortal body. Though it still showed the scars of what he had been through on this earth, it was no longer now subject to the limitations of humanity, but was in fact glorified and immortal. Amen. And we know that he forever sits at the right hand of the Father, that he is the bride to the bridegroom, or the groom to the bridegroom. He is the groom to the bride, and that he is coming again as a redeeming Savior. One, to redeem his bride. The second, to return as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen. What a great, glorious day that'll be. And I believe we'll come with him as the saints of heaven, the hordes of heaven with that. Amen. The clouds. Now, I am not looking for judgment to arrive. I am looking for the church to depart. That doesn't mean that I don't believe the church will go through cleansing. It's not to say that I don't believe that the church will go through times of testing and trials and tribulations. But it does mean that I believe that before the judgment arrives, as it was with Noah, so will it be with us. Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. So I believe that the way that the world was functioning during that time is the way that our world will function before he comes. But as he did with Noah, I think he'll do with us as well. And I realize it aggravates some to believe that we would escape the wrath of God. But I wonder where you're at if you believe that God really wants to bring wrath upon his bride. I believe that the Lord wants purity. I believe the Lord wants fidelity. But I don't necessarily believe that God wants to bring wrath upon the children of God. Your verbiage and your terminologies need to be understood in a way that best reflects God's nature and the word of the Lord. I don't believe God is bringing wrath down upon the body of Christ. I believe that he is working to apprehend us and to bring us into a place of his plans. And we'll talk more about that in just a little bit. But there's a reason that we are here. The naysayers may ask, well, how do you get all that? Well, let me give you a reason to validate why I'm here. I'm not here because it's popular to believe that necessarily, but I do believe that it's sound in our deciphering of Scripture to arrive at this conclusion. First and foremost, I believe it's in the chapters. If you'll look throughout the Word of the Lord, as we've already read some of them, I believe that the typologies are there. Again, let me say that God doesn't do anything without a type and a shadow. He always either foreshadows it or he forespeaks it by his prophets, and he foreordains it because of the counsel of his own wisdom. So in that, God has already placed for us an understanding of how that God brings judgment on the world and deliverance to his own. And so it's in the chapters. But I also believe that it's in the chapters that we see that it's in his character, all right? It's in the character. God never punishes the godly with the ungodly. And I believe that the tribulation period, even though overtly it appears to be a time of judgment, it is actually a time of grace, because there are going to be opportunities throughout those time frames to come to know God. And the Lord is not just wiping the earth afresh and a clean like you would a hard drive on a computer, or just like he did through the flood. He is giving the world an opportunity to recognize who he is. As a matter of fact, one of the things that I truly believe is that the church will be removed, and shortly thereafter, Gog and Magog, Russia and possibly China or some other affiliations, or people who know that stuff better than I do, but they're going to come down. They're going to try to make their approach to Israel. I believe that even the reason they can do that is, one, they've gained supremacy as a superpower again, or at least they think they have. America is somehow crippled and unable to defend Israel, and that they are going to attempt to make a play for God's people, and the Lord will instantaneously put a hook in their jaw and drag them away and reveal to a people who exist on the earth minus the church that God is who he says he is. And I believe he will, by great show of his power, reveal himself mighty to those around him so that they are not in line for judgment. Anybody who has the notion that God sits up in heaven with a ball bat ready to beat the daylights out of somebody just because they don't accept Christ is wrong. God's heart is for those who are unsaved, because his desire, he said in 1 Peter, I would that none would perish, but that all would come unto repentance. It's the heart of God for everybody to be saved. This is not open for discussion. You think about it the way you want to. I believe that every book, every name ever of anybody ever written was written down in heaven, and it's only blotted out when it becomes apparent that the heart will not turn to God. I believe it's the will and the heart and the mind and the character of God that everybody be saved, and he's done everything he can. There's nothing more God could do to save you than he's already done. And the reality remains is that many will remain obstinate And the problem with stubborn obstinance is the fact that we have a tendency to stay in it rather than turn from it. But God will show himself mighty, even in the removal of the church. And during that time, salvation can occur as you, like Noah, come into a righteous standing with God by a surrender to his superiority as the only God of heaven. Amen? Noah stood out as righteous before Christ came. Noah stood out as righteous before the Holy Spirit was given. Noah stood out as righteous before the word was written down. It's possible for men to serve the Lord with a pure heart. Our righteousness will never come from our actions, but God understands faith when he sees it. And I believe that during that moment and that period and in that time, God will recognize the righteousness of the people who have decided and determined to draw a line in the sand and say, I belong to the Lord. God does not look to punish the godly with the ungodly. As a matter of fact, I believe that instantaneously, the moment we leave this body, we're in the presence of the Lord. And I believe that we recognize from other scriptures that in the middle of the tribulation period, John seen in his revelation that there were a group of people gathered underneath the throne of God who had been beheaded for his namesake. I believe that it's going to be a time when the Muslim faith has a great opportunity to express itself, because we've already seen in many examples out of the Middle East that when they have a capture and that capture is a Christian, they will oftentimes behead that individual for their faith. I'm believing today that God is never ready to punish the godly with the ungodly, but he will allow for expedience. And I do believe that God will accept readily those who in that tribulation period give themselves over to walk righteously before God with a heart of repentance. Amen. We can talk about that more another day. How do I get to where I get to? Well, one, it's in the chapter. Secondly, it's in his character. If we notice Lot and his crew, we see that God spoke and spoke to Abraham and went to Lot, spent some time with him in that place, and took them out, gave them occasion to leave prior to the judgment that he brought to Sodom and Gomorrah. When you look at Moses, he's in the Ark of the Bulrush. While everybody else was perishing, God had a plan for his righteous one. He set him inside of an ark, set him on the Nile, if you will, and delivered him from the death that were coming to others. Why? Because he's preserving the righteous in an ark, if you will, over time for his purposes. And eventually we know, right, the story of Moses. He rose up and was declared a leader among the nation of Israel and led them out of captivity. We notice that even the children of Israel, during the time of the plagues, what came upon the Pharaoh didn't come upon them. And especially we know that in the final analysis, when they came up underneath the blood, they were preserved as long as they were under the blood. And so we recognize that the character of God is not to punish the godly with the ungodly. It's not to bring the plague to the house of those who are of his family, but he is looking to create a difference so that there's an understanding that a God in heaven knows how to separate those who have chosen to be a part of him. In these cases, those that were born into his family, those that have been selected by God to be a part of that family, of that nation, Israel. You understand my terminologies there. The reality is that in each case, we see that God was about the preservation of his people. And then we realize it's not only in the chapters, and it's not only in the character, but as we close this today, let's also recognize that it is in Christ. Amen? The Bible tells us in 1 John 2:2 that he became our propitiation. That's a big $1.50 word that means he became our stand-in for sin's judgment. It doesn't stand to reason that you and I would be judged for sin twice. If my judgment against sin was founded in Christ, then why would I need further judgment against my sin yet again? My sin has been settled in the Lord. My separation from God has been bridged by the cross in Christ. I am not separate from God and awaiting his judgment. I am separate unto God, awaiting his retrieval. And I believe that we see it in the chapters, in the character, and in Christ, that God has a plan to remove the bride prior to the judgment he brings to the world. And it will be. It'll be the same types of judgments that we've seen with Pharaoh, each incrementally working to bring an opportunity for repentance, recognition, redemption, reconciliation, a walk and a decision for righteousness. All of these things are God provided. Even in his judgment, he judges in mercy. He brings forth mercy. Judgment, a period of reflection, repentance, and return. Judgment, a period of reflection, repentance, and return, and so on. God is merciful. And in Christ, he set forth an opportunity for my sin to be judged. Amen? And because my sin is judged now, by faith, I'm a part of the family of God. I realize people say, well, we're all God's children. I get that. We're created in the image of God. But I want you to understand something. If unsaved, unrepented, unregenerated, you are not joint heirs with Jesus. Amen? Jesus is a son, therefore set up to be the inheritor of God's great inheritance, and we are joint heirs with Jesus. I am sons and daughters of God, not by how I was born, but how I was born again. We are all the creation of God. We certainly bear within ourselves, in the context of our creation, the image of the Lord, but that doesn't make us children of God. Faith makes us children of God. Whether you were born to the nation of Israel as a Jew under the father of Abraham, or you were born by faith through Christ in the blood of the Lamb, amen, you are a part of that. But even those that are born in the natural nationality of Judaism, the Jewish nation, are not children of God until they become children of God, amen. They're children of Abraham, sons of Abraham, but they become sons of God when they, through the Son of God, make entrance by faith through that door. The door, the one door. The ark had one door, just as Jesus is the one door of God. God used the ark for Noah. He used an ark for Moses. He used the ark of the covenant for the nation of Israel. And I believe that the cross of Christ is an ark for you and I. And I believe that as we come through the one door, Jesus, we can have access to the Father, and we can have provision in the time of judgment to be able to be brought out ahead of time in order to serve the purposes and plans of God. We'll talk more about that as we unfold in part 3, 4, 5, 600. I don't know how far we're going to go, but if you'll stay with me, I believe we can begin to continue to decipher the word of the Lord and begin to look into it with greater depth and intensity. Join with me next week. If you haven't seen part 1, please do that. If you want some notes, there should be a few of them down here. Want you, if you haven't liked it or you haven't followed it, please do so. That gives us a greater opportunity to have influence on a broader scale. The algorithms will pull us up when people make a call for particular things that they want to hear or see. So we ask you to do that. We also invite you to be with us live in service at 10318 here in Gibsonton, in Riverview on Gibsonton Drive. And if you'll come and be a part of that 10:30 on Sunday mornings, we'd love to meet you, greet you, and have an opportunity to minister the word of the Lord to you. What's being ministered in the pulpit today is different than what I'm preaching and ministering in here. And so we want you to be able to take advantage of both if that's your desire. If you aren't a part of a local body, please connect with one wherever you're at. If you are a part of one, please don't be disconnected from that. If at all possible, reconnect as early as is possible and throw yourself into the work of the ministry and allow the Spirit of the Lord to utilize you as a conduit to get to others. And God will utilize with great joy and privilege the opportunity for your life to be in his hands and the reins of your heart to be in his grip, that he might direct you according to his plan for your life. Amen. We love you. We're praying for you. We're believing great things for you. And we just give God all the praise and glory today. Let me pray for you very quickly. Father, in the name of Jesus, touch every heart and every life in any way and every way that's necessary. And Father, we pray that you would encourage today by your Spirit, your word, in their life, in their soul, in their heart, in their mind. And I pray, God, bring stability and peace to the heart of those who look to you as their source. And God, today we'll give you the praise in Jesus' name. We love you. We thank the Lord for you. We look forward to seeing you again. Join us next week for part 3 of this as we continue, and we'll go from there. We love you guys. Have a great day. Bye-bye.
We hope you've enjoyed this message from CWC Riverview. For more information on this message and other teachings, visit us on cwcriverview.com. If you would like to support the ministry financially, you may give online from our website as well. We want to know what God is doing in your life through this ministry. Connect with us for the latest news on our services, events, and more by following us on Facebook and Instagram. God bless you and your family. We'll see you again very soon.